A win is a win. A win is a win. I don't care what y'all say. A win is a win.
Generally, my point was, is that the fucking Ten Commandments from the Bible?
I believe that your very existence is a sin against my Lord and Savior, and that you don't deserve rights or gender-affirming care.
Well, we didn't ask to be this way, and we just want to be accepted and treated like normal human beings. So we're obviously never going to get to agree if you think me just being me is sinful.
Guys, can't we all just get along? You guys have to stop attacking each other, man.
I've never attacked them. I just want to exist. I'm just trying to exist. What?
I'm just a girl. My nails are used for screwing too!
I'm gonna say something, and I mean this in the most gender-positive, body-positive way possible. But until everybody can walk around freely and safely without a shirt on, then I think it's wildly inappropriate that cis men do it. I'm talking like on the street, not at the beach, like places where people wouldn't normally do that, you know? Because if your whole thing is like, well, I'm hot and I can, so I will, like, we're hot too. Or like, well, it's not my fault that, you know, the world is like this. Like, no, actually it is. It's your collective responsibility. It's definitely not our fault. Like, you can't just contribute to a world where people don't feel free and safe, take their shirts off unless they're cis men, and then go and do it. And I'm not saying that if you do it, you're like actively and consciously asserting your privilege or whatever, but the impact is that you are. So by not doing it, be an act of solidarity for people who can't, until we all can.
No. I'm not going to get thicker skin, and I don't think anyone else should either.
I'm so glad that somebody is talking about this, and I just really, like, please look at this video, because I need all of us to tattoo this on our foreheads. No, we are not developing thicker skin or tougher skin. Y'all need to stop being so cruel and mean. For some reason, the internet has convinced a lot of y'all that it's the green light for y'all to treat people cruelly and to say whatever you want without repercussion or consequence. And it is our duty as people on the receiving end of it to just let it slide off our backs. When I say that y'all are a reflection, and I say this a lot, y'all are a reflection of your parents. And I mean that in the most derogatory way possible. Y'all are mean, y'all are nasty, y'all are cruel to people. You are a reflection of your parents. Really, you need to look at that. It's not normal. There are some people who deserve it. Don't get me wrong. Some people do deserve it. People who are openly bigoted, like openly bigoted, who hate or who want to oppress other groups of people. Those people with those beliefs, yeah, sometimes they need to get a good whacking every now and again. But people who, like, everybody don't deserve that. And y'all just go searching for reasons, and that's sick. Y'all need to get some help, and y'all need to stop telling people to toughen up. Take it away, mute.
Stop scrolling. It is urgent and important. This is Jelani Levin. On September 22nd, 2021, he was found dead in what they said is an overdose in Los Angeles' largest jail facility. His family and the public has been fighting against it. There is evidence that says otherwise of brutal and physical abuse. Jelani's toxicology report comes in opposite of what LASD have said. Here's the time-sensitive part of it all. Tomorrow there will be a protest at MCJ. I need everybody to get the hell outside. We need to make some noise from Jelani and make sure that we get the word out there that we will not be tolerating this disrespect and this brutal racism that has been happening to black men nationwide. Can't make it tomorrow? Then everybody needs to be posting Jelani's picture on the internet. Make this shit go dark. Talk to the goddamn people.
Obviously, don't go and do that.
Hey, you do whatever you like.
We can't condone anything of the sort.
No, we can't. Live! Live!
Wash day is not the day of the week when black people take showers.
And this right here is why, and I've said it before, I'll say it again, this is why I will never feel bad for making fun of the white people who get on here and literally brag about not washing their ass. Like, I get so many comments and be like, that's not fair, it's not nice, you don't know what everybody's situation is. I am not talking about people who can't afford to take a shower every day, or they're having a mental health situation and they can't get in the shower every day. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about people who specifically get on here and make videos where they're like, yeah, I don't wash my ass, I don't get in the shower every day, I don't wash my legs, I don't use a washcloth. Like, you can post about that, you can do whatever you want, but I can sure as fuck make fun of you for it, and especially because our entire lives, like, people of color have been made fun of for being dirty and, like, assumed to be dirty, despite the fact that most people of color have way better hygiene habits than your average white person. We've all heard the story about how the indigenous people had to teach the settlers how to fucking bathe. Y'all will hear black people talk about how we don't wash our hair every day because a lot of us have hair types that would be severely damaged if we were to wash them every day. And y'all are like, oh, so you don't take a shower? Ew, you must stink. Like, I will never forget that at times that I have mentioned that I don't wash my hair every day and had white friends looking at me crazy. Meanwhile, y'all are actually the ones out here not washing your fucking asses. So damn right I'm gonna make fun of you. Particularly when you get on this app and brag about it. I just let the water run down. I don't wash my legs. I don't wash my feet. I don't wash my kids, but once a week when they're itching and scratching. Like, if y'all are gonna do that, then I'm gonna continue to laugh at you.
I'ma just say this, I teach 7th grade, they are still performing on the 4th grade level.
7th grade English teacher here. I teach in Northern Houston, and I teach at one of the more affluent schools. When I tell you that these babies cannot read, they cannot write, and they cannot comprehend, I'm not being funny. I'm being dead serious. It doesn't exist. I have kids constantly asking me, how do I spell window? How do I spell important? How do I spell though? And they be serious. They're dead serious. I could ask them, who is the main character of your story? The story of four paragraph story we just read. Can't tell you. They don't know. They don't know. They don't know. It took us 4 weeks, to get through how to answer a question in a complete sentence.
Just a little bit of media literacy for a second, okay? Let's view things with a little bit more of a critical eye here. Now, theater kids are inherently insufferable, but this is ridiculous. Why do you think this is the prevailing narrative around this movie right now? Because it's important to understand not just what's happening, but when it's happening. That video of Rachel Zegler was taken at a picket line, in which actors and writers are fighting for fair pay. Additionally, those actors and writers cannot talk about struck work. And there are dozens of influencers who have pledged to do the same. Y'all keep comparing this to Halle. I'm sorry, wasn't Halle redhead erasure? None of you actively talk about the difference in studio communication plans. The studio intervened with Halle to prime the audience. The studio is not intervening with Rachel. Why? Because by encouraging this discourse campaign against Rachel Zegler, they've gotten you all to talk about struck work. And because of the iconicness of the character, they've gotten you to present actors as bratty people who don't deserve fair wages and just need to shut up and dribble. Played right into their hand. A majority of white veganism is luring people to the alt-right pipeline. Ask me how I know. Trigger warnings for racism, anti-Semitism, xenophobia, all the isms. If you have an ism, it's in here. Now is your time to scroll away if you don't want abuse from vegans. This all started because I asked about non-dairy cheeses. Now, as you all know, I'm lactose intolerant and belligerent about it. So I was asking for non-dairy cheeses to be a little bit softer on my tum-tums. What ensued was a barrage of racist, anti-Semitic, xenophobic, homophobic, transphobic attacks on me. Because I'm not vegan. And you know what I like to do? I like to kick up dust, even when I'm the lightning rod for it. I like to see how people communicate and organize. And the easiest way to get their baseline sentiment is to embody everything they find disposable in the first place. And what I found is that a majority of white vegans are using white supremacist tactics and talking points, but superimposing veganism over it all. And we see this a lot when it comes to white pro-life evangelicals. This is the tweet that started it all. I literally asked about non-dairy cheeses that melt. And as they are wont to do, vegans inserted themselves in the conversation. Now, some vegans gave me suggestions, but they were black and brown people who did so with kindness. So they're not who we're talking about today. No, white vegans inserted themselves to berate me over not being vegan in the first place. Even though this was clearly an opportunity. One of the methodologies that I find that white vegans use is that they pick the perfect victim. Much in the same way that white evangelical Christians use the unborn, white vegans use animals as a proxy so that they can be oppressed. Neither one of those groups are fighting for the actual oppressed. What they aim to do is position themselves as a proxy in absence of actually being an oppressed group of people. And it's particularly easy because, like with the unborn, animals can't speak for themselves. So it's perfect for them. And it is from that vantage point of that appropriated oppression that they get to decide which other life matters. Which is where we get this wanton disregard for human atrocities and the comparison of marginalized people to animals. Which is why we have Francesca here comparing animal agriculture to human slavery and denying women the right to vote. They also disregard the needs of disabled people and poor people who have very valid concerns about their ability to go vegan. To them, human suffering is just a toy, a tool with which, from their own vantage point of assumed oppression, they get to decide who lives and who dies. Ultimately, human suffering is just chess pieces. Additionally, when you go back into some of these people's profiles, you see comparisons of not being vegan to sexual assault. And it's minimization, which does not make sense in their own logic. You have quite classic framing often used by pro-lifers too, such as the minimization of the Holocaust and calling animal agriculture the Holocaust, therefore comparing Jewish people to animals and livestock. Similarly, you have this individual that I screenshotted before they had the opportunity to delete it, who said they wanted to wipe out the entire bloodline of a Jewish person who was talking about keeping kosher. And while this may have been a troll, very real people agreed with them and minimized the anti-Semitic remarks that were said. Keep in mind, this exact same person represents themselves quite differently on other subject matter. It's a bit hypocritical, don't you think? You then have this vegan saying that chattel slavery was merely a blip compared to animal exploitation. And then this person even tweeted at me a picture of dead black people, comparing them to meat. Because black people are always going to be livestock to vegans. And again, all of this is because I asked if vegan cheese melts. And another disturbing aspect is how they weaponize this thing called speciesism, basically acting like it's reverse racism. Because again, they see themselves as a proxy for these animals. They're just utilizing their veganism as a mechanism to be racist. Because looking at everything that was said to me yesterday, and keep in mind, this is just a handful of the thousands of comments like this that I got. They can't possibly be or even want to convert people to veganism. That, in and of itself, is not their goal. With these numbers, they can't even pretend to want to be effective. Veganism is just their placeholder for the moral superiority felt with Christianity. It's like when abusers in the church go into New Age spirituality. They get to pretend and adopt a moral superiority while simultaneously benefiting from the exact same structures that they pretend that they're getting away from. Additionally, they're not recruiting new vegans. They're making sure that the existing ones don't leave the Albright pipeline that they're leading them along. It's the same reason why evangelicals do not expect more people to convert to Christianity. They expect existing Christians to bond over their assumed oppression. Because their identity is formed not based off of who they are, but who they are not. And they are victims of the people who do not believe what they believe. Many of these same vegan accounts were following and retweeting right-wing and alt-right accounts, liking and reposting racist, transphobic, homophobic, anti-Semitic, all the ism type of things. If these are your brand ambassadors for white veganism, then would you want to be vegan? In fact, that was a major part of the discussion that was had yesterday. Quite a few black and brown people who are technically vegans do not want to identify as such, to not be lumped in with that. Because why would you want to sidle up to a racist over chicken nuggets? Anyways, I keep a 14-point list on why I can't stand white vegans. And you can find the entire list on my Twitter account with alt text. So let me know, does this behavior make you want to become vegan and save the animals? Or do you not want to sidle up to a group of people whose greatest organizing goal is to just enforce whiteness by a different name. I encourage everybody to look at my mentions over the last 2 days to see who you all are really represented by.
Actually own 2 houses already. I do Airbnb and rent them out.
Avery Cyrus would be contributing to the housing crisis.
I always forget just how many white women follow me until I make a post about a racial or cultural issue that is relevant to them. Because then I'm reminded not just about how white women will flip from we're all in this together, like I'm your woke ally, to an absolute raging monster the minute you say, hey, I wish you wouldn't do that, but just how many will flip. And then it hit me that when a lot of white women hear my content, they separate themselves from white, focus on the woman, and then think that somehow we're on the same plane. And so when I'm talking about white people, they find themselves like somehow distanced from that in their heads. But when I call them out specifically, white women, they respond just like white men because they can't separate themselves because they've been called out practically by name. And now people who follow me are calling me racist, hateful, bitter, jealous, every name in the book. And not only is it fascinating to see just how flimsy y'all's allyship is, but it also completely explains why we live in the political landscape we're in now.
How'd you survive that OD?
What do you mean?
I mean, somebody had to save your life, right?
It's my sister.
Now, first and foremost, I'd like to say that I really do like hippies. I really do like manifestation, astrology, all of these things that are often taken from other groups. Groups like Buddhists, Hindu people, indigenous groups, Native Hawaiians in this case, right? Manifestation, astrology, all these things sometimes are westernized to be palatable for people like this girl who's singing the song, who I don't want to, you know, be mad at, because that's not the point. The point is, I just want to say that we are the smallest minority in this country, Native Hawaiian Kanaka, right? Given that our culture is vultured and stolen by groups super rapidly all the time. Wear a costume, people will say aloha and mahalo to me as soon as they see my name. And they'll say phrases that they don't really understand, and they'll be asked in their comments what they mean. And that is my problem, because you don't get to be the narrator of Olelo Hawaii when it was illegal for many years for us to speak in our native tongue. It's not palatable if I say it. It's palatable for people like her to say it in her like converted camper van and singing a song where she's talking about manifestation. Our culture and our language is important, just like our Aina is. And a lot of indigenous people are really connected to the land because that's a given, right? Of course. Being indigenous to somewhere makes you more appreciative of it. And there's nothing wrong with you appreciating our culture. The problem is when Kanaka go in your comments and say, oh, well, that's not actually, I mean, that's not how I'd say it. This is how I'd say it. And it feels a little appropriation. Other people are saying it's not appropriation if she's using it correctly. You do not, and I'm going to say this one time and one time only, you do not get to tell Kanaka what is appropriation and what isn't.